Microphone check. 1, 2. The microphone check. 1, 2, 1, 2. The microphone check. I got my headphones tuned between two different AM stations, and my briefcase is full of declassified information. Declassified. Declassified.
Good evening and welcome to News from Neptune for the 28th week of 2015. Since the summer of 1990, this program has been a spontaneous and unrehearsed discussion of the news of the week and its coverage by the media, first on a so-called community radio station, and when censored and locked out of there, welcomed, I'm happy to say, by the good people at Urbana Public Television. I'm Carl Estabrook. My discussants tonight are David Green and Ron Szoke. Our program is produced and directed by Jason Liggett and Dan Pano. Our program's name, News from Neptune, was chosen to honor Noam Chomsky, who's been talking sense about American politics for twice the quarter century we've been on the air. Chomsky has said that in the American media, quote, either you repeat the same conventional doctrines everybody is saying, or else you say something true and it will sound like it's from Neptune. This and previous editions of this program are archived on YouTube and posted to the Facebook page for News from Neptune, where you'll also find comments from viewers, articles we've referred to, and further comments from us. I can be reached at carl@newsfromneptune.com. And I'm happy to receive your comments. Today is the 10th of July. On this day in 1991, Boris Yeltsin took office as President of Russia, a step in the breakup of the USSR. By December, all except Russia and Kazakhstan had formally declared independence. During this time, Yeltsin took over what remained of the Soviet government, including the Kremlin, and the final blow was struck on December 1st, when Ukraine, the second most powerful republic, voted overwhelmingly for independence. Ukraine's secession ended any realistic chance of the Soviet Union staying together, even on a limited scale. On the 8th of December, 1991, the presidents of Russia, Ukraine, and Belarus, formerly Belorussia, I know I'm going to have trouble with that, signed the Belavezhia Accords, which declared the Soviet Union dissolved and established the Commonwealth of Independent States in its place. While doubts remained over the authority of the Accords to do this, on 21st December 1991, the representatives of all Soviet republics except Georgia signed the Alma-Ata Protocol, which confirmed the Accords. On Christmas Day 1991, Gorbachev resigned as the president of the USSR, declaring the office extinct. He turned the powers that had been vested in the presidency over to Yeltsin. That night, the Soviet flag was lowered for the last time, and the Russian tricolor was raised in its place. Now, it's worthwhile to recall the events attending the breakup of the Soviet Union because they've never been very well presented, I think, in the American context. It was the Clinton administration that tried to take advantage of the breakup of the Soviet Union by an aggressive policy of first extending NATO, as the Bush administration had begun to do, to the borders of the Soviet Union, which has obvious ramifications today, and attempting basically to reduce the Russian economy, supposedly the great competitor of the United States, although it was never more than half the size of the American economy, to a third world status. That was the conscious intention of the Clinton administration, and in many ways it was successful. While Yeltsin was president of Russia, the life expectancy of men in the Soviet Union actually declined substantially because of a depression worse than the depression of the 1930s in the United States. At the end of this period, the Clinton administration launched a war on Serbia, which covered over with the usual lies about how we were protecting people who didn't seem to need our protection very much. The goal was to further reduce the Soviet Union as a competitor, the former Soviet Union as a competitor of the United States. And on the recent anniversaries of Clinton's attack on Serbia, we didn't hear much discussion about that, if we heard any discussion at all. But it's the crucial background to the policies of the current Democratic administration in regard to Ukraine and the Soviet Union. The point of American policy from the Clinton administration through the Obama administration is to exert American economic hegemony in Eurasia, and in order to do that, the Obama administration has been even more belligerent than the Clinton administration was in its limited war in Serbia. A very dangerous situation results, and of course what we hear from our political leaders is that this is all a matter of Russian aggression and that madman Putin, who is the new Hitler. These are lies about American policy that are some of the most extreme that I've heard in my lifetime, and that's saying something. So you're watching a News from Neptune episode, a perfidious Democrat edition. There are a lot of perfidious Democrats around, and on Yeltsin's accession day, we'll remember him as one of them. We'll begin tonight with Ron Zoot.
Yes, well, I'm wearing my protective hat because I'm feeling victimized by microaggression, and it helps me feel safe and not so to feel so threatened and unsafe in case someone wants to disagree with me.
Or hit you in the head.
Yeah, right. That, well, that to me represents aggression. And my only problem with it is it was originally defined apparently as something that can be suffered only by black people. And there's a conceptual trick that is sometimes used in these kinds of discussions. Sometimes racism is defined as something that applies only to white people. Only white people can be racist, and they are all racist, and black people can never be racist. So you guys might tell me, can black people sometimes be racist? What is your judgment there? I want to get to, maybe I'm being a little provocative today. I want to get to something that's been on my mind for some time, this business of a free lunch and how confused Americans generally seem to be about this. I have before me two books, one by Milton Friedman, the economist at the University of Chicago, who was a rather noisy ideologue on the question of free markets and laissez-faire and all of that. And his collection of popular articles is called There's No Such Thing as a Free Lunch. Professor Friedman's famous aphorism, There's No Such Thing as a Free Lunch, is a summary of his economic views and is quoted endlessly by a growing band of Friedmanites. The aphorism is his shorthand way of saying a lot of things about fiscal reality. Every bit of pork, every subsidy, every inflation, every politically imposed inefficiency is paid for and paid for in full by someone. In this collection, Professor Friedman makes the dismal science of fun and makes economics an exciting adventure. Whether he is writing about tight money, price controls, inflation, wages, gold, unemployment, blacks, or welfare, he dispenses a prophetic wisdom that no economist should miss and no thoughtful person should ignore.
I wonder what they'd say in Chile about that.
Right, right. So the other one I want to mention then is this book by David K. Johnson, a prominent reporter with the Pulitzer Prize-winning reporter for the New York Times, called Free Lunch: How the Wealthiest Americans Enrich Themselves at Government Expense and Stick You with the Bill. Free lunch answers the great mystery of our time. How did our strong and growing economy give way to job uncertainty, debt, bankruptcy, and fear for millions of Americans? Acclaimed reporter David K. Johnson reveals how government policies and spending have reached deep into the wallets of the many to benefit the top 10th of 1% of the wealthiest. He shows exactly who has been getting free lunches from the government, from a $100 million taxpayer gift to Warren Buffett, to a $1.3 billion to the owners of the Yankees and the Mets, but of course there's really no such thing as a free lunch. The taxpayer always picks up the bill. With his in-depth reporting, vivid stories, and sharp analysis, Johnston reveals the forces that shape our everyday economic lives and show us how we can finally make things better. So one of the things that's mystified me is the number and size of the incentives that are offered to businesses to locate in certain places. For example, I have a clipping here from the local daily going back to April 28th of this year. Champaign plans up to $710,000 in incentives, deal similar to the offer made for County Market in Campus Town. So tax write-offs, tax holidays, outright subsidies, and so on, are all over the place if you are wealthy enough and threatening to move somewhere else or not locate in a certain place. But they're generally not available to poor people who are not in a position to make any such threats. An outstanding case is sports facilities. I think that's what he's alluding to here when they talk about the Yankees and the Mets. Did they build sports stadiums on public money?
Public money, exactly.
Yeah. This is how George W. Bush became wealthy. Getting, who was it?
Texas Rangers.
The Texas Rangers, the stadium used by them, which is or was municipally supported when it was built. And then I don't know how much rent they're charged every time they use it. But again, we have a story of socialized expenses and privatized profits.
Exactly.
So, so this has been going on for some time. It's kind of pervasive, but I'm going to ask my colleagues here what they think about that and see if they start pounding on my head. But
but you're protected.
Yeah, right. That's why I'm protected today. So with that topic, I'll stop there.
Thank you, Rob. You want to respond on racism or socialism, David?
Well, no, I think if whether or not blacks can be racist is one thing, but whether they can be institutionally racist is something else.
That's the important distinction.
In a society in which, you know, in which we really need to talk about institutional racism against blacks by an upper class that includes blacks, that might make more sense, I guess. You can call Obama kind of an institutional racist in that regard. In fact, I think his tenure has been and that especially of Eric Holder, who was in the news this week, can certainly be defined in terms of institutional racism as insofar as it relates to the bankers and the people that benefited from bailouts and the blacks that did not benefit from being rescued from their home mortgage foreclosures and so forth. So I think when we talk about racism, to talk about it at the individual level is to rather trivialize it. To talk about it in terms of just attitudes or people saying nasty things, I mean, that's not a good thing. And I think it's important. I mean, people on a college campus or in a high school or a middle school, you find people treating each other really badly. You find people's feelings being hurt all the time. When the efforts to point out the fact that some individuals may come to feel that they're made to feel uncomfortable because of their race or their background in other ways, perhaps is a different level of that and how it should be addressed relative to the normal conflictual attitudes that young people and indeed old people have with each other. That's another issue. So might be good to sort of.
What about when people look at me in a threatening and unpleasant way.
Shall I do that now?
Go ahead.
Well, it's probably something you've done.
or something you said.
Yeah, yeah. But, yeah, I mean, no, I understand the I understand the satirical and sort of skepticism that you bring to this issue. But I think it's one of those issues. I don't know if you'd specifically define it as an identity politics issue,
yes,
which I'm critical of.
Yep.
I get, Carl, I think you probably would.
I would, yes.
But if you choose not to define it strictly in that way, you can even if so, you can say that the kind of issues that are raised on this campus and that are quite willingly raised by people like Phyllis Wise,
yes,
in the context of promoting civility and inclusion on this campus, one can see that this is a part of the identity politics discourse,
right,
that kind of takes our eye off the ball of what's going on at a broader institutional level.
I think even you may be being gentle here, David.
I'm known as a pretty gentle person.
Well, there is that.
Yeah.
You know, that's fine.
A gentleman.
But the disingenuous use of these notions of microaggression and whatnot are perhaps no place locally better illustrated than in this Stephen Salaita case, mm-hmm, where the chancellor of the university said that what she was doing was making sure, in violating Stephen Salaita's academic freedom, what she was doing was making sure that students in his classes would not be made uncomfortable,
yeah,
by his views, that she was protecting them, in other words, from this sort of microaggression.
Yeah. Another letter in today's local paper following this line that Salaita was sure to say things that would upset
exactly
some people. Yeah,
exactly.
Right.
And I mean that passes beyond foolishness to a vicious use of this sort of identity politics. And indeed that should be exposed and objected to quite properly. There's many more to say, but I mean, I think David has made the essential distinction between institutional racism and racial prejudice. You can be prejudiced against all sorts of people based upon their racial identifications, and there's been a lot of talk about how we get racial identifications in the first place. But if you happen to think Poles and Hungarians deserve your contempt simply because they're Poles or Hungarians, or if you prefer Irish and English, that's a racial prejudice, perhaps, but it becomes a political issue when it becomes institutionalized,
yeah,
when it becomes a matter of legal structure.
Yeah.
Racism is a legal structure. I was born in a racist state, or I grew up in a racist state, the state of Virginia, where, in fact, the laws discriminated against people on the basis of their racial identities. For example, a black person couldn't marry a white person in the Commonwealth of Virginia when I was young. There were laws against it. Now, that's racism, unquestionably, and I'm happy to say that those laws that privileged one race over another were struck down in the state of Virginia as part of the civil rights movement. That's very good. That's not to say that racial prejudice still doesn't exist in Virginia. Of course it does. But the laws that institutionalize it, they're gone. Now, when we say that Israel is a racist state, what we mean is that the laws of Israel privilege one group defined by descent over against another. That is racism. And the state is a racist state by definition. But it seems to me that we get into serious intellectual trouble, I mean, when we confuse that with racial prejudice.
Yeah.
And that's that has been a move in American politics for 40 years now.
Yeah, but people seem fascinated by just personal expressions of personal dislike or nastiness and so on, and instead they'll begin talking about who's a nice guy and who's not, and can we move that above the individual level of people being nasty to each other to some kind of what is called systemic or structural racism.
Yeah. Well, it raises the issue of, when it gets to the point where a young man is so infused with racial hatred that he goes and kills people in a church or anywhere else, then we can begin to talk about what the relationships are between the psychology of that and the politics of it. But again, the psychology wouldn't even happen in the first place if Dylann Roof wasn't growing up in a culture in which was institutionally and economically divided along racial lines. I mean, he wouldn't have had that particular. He may have been disturbed in various ways and figured out some dysfunctional way to express that or violent way, but it wouldn't necessarily have been in a racial context. He wouldn't have had that to sort of glom onto to explain the world to him.
Yeah. Well, this has got diverted into a question of the flag and what it represents. What
yes, it
means.
Has been diverted. Yeah.
Yeah. Yes,
and,
exactly.
And not that it isn't. Not that it isn't. You know, a decent sort of symbolic issue, but it remains a symbolic issue.
Precisely
and,
right.
Yeah. And so, and I think many commentators who've talked about it have pointed that out. I mean, I think that's been a pretty well expressed view on the left, that Paul Street and people like that wrote a very good column, which is on both Counterpunch and Z. And I think, you know, we need to keep getting back to the institutional background.
Yeah. Okay, well, I wanted to move on then.
Well, I wanted to talk about free lunch, since I'm feeling hungry.
Yeah,
right.
No, I do too.
We do film this at lunchtime, and I'm feeling
appropriate
they should talk about a free lunch. But I had never really thought about it. I mean, it's sort of a silly phrase, and, you know, you don't know how to deal with a slogan like that. But, you know, when you think about it, it's really like it's a kind of a straw man set up by someone like Milton Friedman or whoever thought of this.
Sure.
It could have been Marx who thought of it, for crying out. It doesn't matter. But of course there's no free lunch. Nobody ever said there was a free lunch. It's a way of distorting the issue. It's a way of sort of accepting the assumption that government wants to give people free stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
And that they shouldn't get free stuff.
Right. Bars used to advertise free lunch all the time.
Yeah. Pardon?
Bars used to advertise.
Yeah, right. Yeah. And so it's like,
when you were buying drinks.
You know, no good Marxist, no good leftist, any good leftist understands that there's no free lunch, because there's always going to be somebody's work going into making the food that goes into your lunch or preparing your lunch. There's no free lunch whether your mother is feeding it to you or whether you've stolen it from, you know, the lunch counter. So this is just, getting, to talk about that, for Milton Friedman to talk about that, is just a way of setting up a series of, assumptions about government and private enterprise and money. It's confusing labor and actual goods with money, and it's getting us off to a real bad start in analyzing how our economy actually works and the fact that government can actually give you stuff and do stuff for you, and it does every day, and it darn well should.
Wasn't he famous as a monetarist who,
in
effect, said that only money matters? And,
that might be oversimplifying what he said, but
that's what we do.
But that was. Right.
I mean, he had to eat. I mean, he had to eat real food. He couldn't eat money. But yeah.
And I think the reference to taxes in the "there's no free lunch" announcement is important because of the assumptions we make about taxes. Normally, the "no free lunch" line is used in order to attack those people who seem to want free stuff, whether they're blacks or Greeks. What that covers over is the immense maldistribution of the immense inequality in American society and indeed in world society, and provide a sort of a subterranean justification for it. You know, they want free stuff, and they shouldn't be given free stuff. We saw Mr. Romney try to use that in the last presidential
right.
election.
They want to be given things,
and, yeah,
things and stuff.
So it's worth analyzing yeah. from several directions. But one thing we should talk about is the notion that everything has to be paid for by tax money. The question is, what are you going to tax? In our society, as a result of the success of the 1% over a century, we assume that taxes mean income taxes, and that income taxes are the only interesting way, so to speak, that we can finance government. First of all, it isn't true. And secondly, there are taxes other than income taxes. As to point one, John Kenneth Galbraith made a point of saying no one ever turns down a check signed by the United States of America. The U.S. is not going to go broke, as people on the right and the left sometimes say, because it hasn't extracted enough from income taxes. Secondly, one of the things we've come to realize in recent discussion of taxes is that the notion of taxing income itself may well be a serious mistake. If you tax something, you get less of it, eh? That's the thought behind cigarette taxes, gasoline taxes, even liquor taxes, right? You want to decrease the overuse of these commodities, therefore you put a tax on it. And you raise some revenue at the same time. If that's true, then we shouldn't be taxing income at all, nor should we be taxing businesses. What we want to do is tax things that we don't want too much of. We don't want too much differential wealth in this society. And in fact, the 40-year history of the United States is a rush towards increasing differential wealth. And increasing differential wealth, the second derivative is positive too, that is at a greater rate. Now, if that's true, what we should be doing is taxing wealth, not income, and we should look at that differential wealth and make sure that we use the tax code to redress it, to reestablish or to move in the direction of equality rather than inequality as the present tax code does. If that were the discussion, I'd be perfectly happy to be talking about who's paying for lunch.
Yeah.
By the way,
It's led to this observation then by some that we've entered a stage, actually for some time now, of private opulence and public squalor. And there's not enough money for the public services that people need, the most vulnerable people in society, as it's often said, but enormous popularity among the top 1/10th or 1/100th of 1% of their $100 million homes and yachts and all of that goes on.
But that,
people are sometimes amazed at the rate at which luxury goods are moving today.
That puts a fine point on what you were saying earlier about sports stadiums, or stadia, I guess you might say, if you want to be Latin about it. These wealthy people were perfectly happy for a couple decades there to build these lavish sports complexes in almost all of the major cities of this country, with the justification that it was good for the economy and good for jobs and all that stuff, and that is only part of the whole process by which the people who claim that there's no free lunch and that that the free market will take care of everything if you just let it work right, that didn't quite work in terms of sports, in terms of building $500 million bill. It started out in the $100 million range, then it went up to $500 million. Now it's $1 billion stadiums, especially football stadiums, and there hasn't. You know, they can justify this because they don't care if they contradict themselves. Nobody calls them on it, and that's the way it goes. I think Dave Zirin had an interesting column this week about the fact that this is a little bit of a sidetrack, but L.A. hasn't been a sports, hasn't had a pro football team for many years now. And he pointed out that one of the reasons they don't have a football team is that when everybody, and anybody who wants to get more money in their city from their taxpayers to build a stadium, they threaten to move their football team to L.A., and then and then they cough up the money. So L.A. is too valuable to all these football owners as a city without a football team. And being right. from L.A. myself, and actually having grown up as a fan of the L.A. Rams in those days, I kind of get the feeling that L.A. doesn't much care anymore whether there's a pro football team there. I think they've gotten along pretty well. You know, not that isn't sports crazed place like everywhere else in this country, but. I don't know. Football just doesn't seem to work there anymore.
Maybe the question is, who is L.A.? Yeah. I mean, are we talking here about, know, the... I mean, the news this week included the fact that California now has more Latino residents than white residents. So, I mean, are we looking at a... I mean, you know, maybe we have a push for a soccer stadium. In
yeah,
L.A.
That, perhaps.
You're watching News from Neptune, where we have descended to the level of sports, but hey, that happens.
Well, there's a broader issue there, I think, of the privatization of public funds. Yeah. And it goes on with military contracts and things
absolutely.
All the time.
It's a very sort of hypocritical discourse, like everything else in the mainstream media regarding the free market and so forth.
I notice on my list of topics for today that there are, in fact, a number of items that have turned up this week that deserves our attention, from Greece to Iran, from the BRICS and the Shanghai Cooperation Organization to the Russian military threat. That we were advised about this week, descending finally to perfidious Democrats in Illinois. Do we want to take up any of these, David?
Where do you want to start? I was going that since you labeled the show in that way, and since that was on my mind.
Well, it was Boris Yeltsin who did it for me, and his antagonists in the Clinton administration.
At the national level, I think what I've been wanting to raise is the issue of how we deal with Bernie Sanders. It's being talked about quite a bit, and I think it relates to the local level. I'm not necessarily calling Bernie Sanders a perfidious Democrat. He's not really even a Democrat formally.
You're not calling him a perfidious Democrat because he's not a Democrat.
Or a Democrat, or not even maybe not perfidious either. He is in some ways, but I think there's been some reasonable discourse on the left about Bernie Sanders and the nature of his candidacy and how it should be supported, if it should be supported, how it should be supported. I think it is a good thing that Bernie Sanders is saying the things that he is saying, especially about, you know, what we generally call the field of social democracy or sort of Scandinavian democracy in this country. Of course, he's weak on foreign policy. Of course, he's not critical of Israel and all that stuff that he's rightly criticized for on the left, but. That really isn't necessarily a reason for people on the left who want to raise these issues to the fore and to see Hillary Clinton be given a hard time and to sort of expose the mainstream Democratic Party for what it is, that he shouldn't be doing that. But on the other hand, you know, to do a kind of either or on the other hand argument about this, we all know that this is not going to, the chances of this working are very, very small. That Sanders, you know, getting big crowds is one thing. We've heard this before. We've heard enthusiastic crowds. I've been hearing about enthusiastic crowds ever since Barry Goldwater. Yeah. And that doesn't mean a whole lot when it comes to the money involved in these campaigns and what people do when they go to the polls. And I think that Sanders will be overwhelmed. And then, of course, there will be the usual process that's been done before by Jackson and Kucinich, where he will have to, in order to survive politically, he will have to support the nominee of the Democratic Party, which will be Clinton. But let's enjoy some of the relatively honest views that he's putting forward while we can, and use that to make the points that we're making beyond the Democratic Party.
Oh, you're such an optimist, David. Do you buy any of this, Ron?
Well, yeah. I mean, it's a temporary thing going forward for the next few months. I would support Bernie Sanders as much as possible. Maybe Jill Stein, but it doesn't make any difference anyway. In the end, money will be what counts. And she has an enormous amount of it. And he's been doing very well initially. But these initial bursts of enthusiasm and big crowds and so on will, I think, dwindle away. And big money will do what it always seems to do and win the day.
So David's an optimist and you're a cynic, and
I'm stuck in the middle.
I'm
not an optimist about Sanders winning.
No, right.
I'm just...
About his candidacy, though, I think it's a good thing.
I'm more avoiding cynic. I'm against cynicism in regards to it. Now, I mean, the process is cynical enough, other than that the left should, at the very start, should be saying, well, Bernie this and Bernie that. I mean, I was kind of thinking that for a while, and there's part of me that still thinks that. And maybe I'm feeling a little peer pressure from people who are saying, you know, don't just be cynical. And there's something to,
why not?
There's something to be said for the sort of self-fulfilling prophecy that's involved in having negative attitudes at the start. But I mean, part of me is just sort of waiting for this to play out, and hopefully there can be opportunities to generate some discourse, which actually wasn't at all a part of the campaign, say, when Obama was running against Clinton in the primaries in 2008. It became apparent early on that there's no real hope and change involved in either of these political campaigns, which is easy to say in retrospect, but it was clear then as well. Sanders, at least, is not Hillary Clinton. I mean, he is running to the left of Hillary Clinton in a way that Obama was not running to the left of Hillary Clinton. If anything, he may have been running to the right of her. I can't recall.
The 2008 election?
Yeah, in the 2008 primaries. Yeah.
No, 2008 primary? I would say that, in fact, that Obama became president precisely because he could co-opt the anti-war movement, co-opt those people who objected to the Bush pro-war, pro-Wall Street policies, and he was able to manipulate Clinton, to borrow a phrase, he was able to triangulate Clinton in that regard. And the people who went to the polls in the primaries, they looked at Clinton and they said, oh, Clinton, that's too close to the Bush administration. It's only Obama who's suggesting hope and change, an anti-war and anti-Wall Street campaign, and Clinton will slip back into those same old patterns. That made him president. Isn't that true?
Yeah. Well, yeah.
I mean, no, I think that, perception that he was some sort of incipient leftist.
I think but that was vital. And the Obama people were very careful about cultivating that. That was the mendacity of hope, the hope that they used and lied about, when in fact what we got with Obama was a president, if anything, was more pro-war and more pro-Wall Street than George Bush was. Certainly his equal in that regard, and more intense and probably more clever in the way in which his pro-war and pro-Wall Street policies were worked out. So, I mean, in that sense, the appearance of a division such as that between Obama and Clinton in 2008 and that between Clinton and Sanders now serves the interests of the pro-Wall Street policies, which Ron says we can't get away from anyhow.
So what's the analogy at the local level? You know, I mean, you went to a meeting last night and not to put you on the spot.
No, but this was important.
You had some things to say about that, so perhaps that would be, we need to discuss this in some way, because I avoided going to the meeting for a change.
It's usually the other way around. You're usually the one who has a capacity for taking pains in this matter, and I'm usually the one who says, I'm sorry, I'm I'm old, I'm staying home.
Well, this talk about perfidious Democrats raises for me certain questions about stereotyping and profiling and group libel and collective punishment. And I think we need to clarify a bit about what we mean there. And do we denounce Democrats en masse?
I'm talking about the policies, the political policies of the parties and the lies they tell about the policies. Obama became president by lying to us. He lied to us in that he led people to believe that hope and change meant a difference in war policy and a difference in economic policy. It meant jobs and not killing so many people abroad. And people said, hey, this is my man. This is what I want. This is what we're after. We want jobs. We want the economic crisis to be dealt with in a way that actually is to our benefit, the majority says, and we want to stop these foreign wars. And they voted for Obama on that basis, and what he delivered was just the opposite. So to the point that in halfway through Obama's presidency, we began to hear from his defenders the fallback position. Well, of course, Obama wants to do the right thing, but he's being prevented from doing so by those vicious Republicans. They're not letting him do the economic transformation that he has in mind. They're not letting him produce a jobs program beyond what he has done. They're not letting him produce peace in the Middle East and a response to Russian aggression. This is the difficulty. Now, you know, that's a fairly standard move, but it's even more nefarious and even more untruthful than the original notion that those were Obama's goals.
So, do you have a position then on this thing? It's always difficult in the law: group libel and defamation.
I don't
denouncing Democrats.
We're talking about political positions taken by various political parties.
Well, it sounds as if you're.
Well, I don't
you're
really
sneering Democrats.
I don't really care about. I'm trying to show that the Democrats are lying about what their position
Which
is.
Which Democrats?
The leaders of the Democratic Party, when they say this is our position. The reasons that people voted for Democrats, including
you don't
most
know
notably
what the
President
reason
Obama.
Was that they voted for anyone. But.
I think we know pretty well why Obama was,
okay,
why
Carl.
People voted
okay.
for Obama.
Okay.
I mean, you know.
But
why?
Again, at the state yeah. level here, you know, what we've had transpired this morning on our listserv is, you know, the fact that our friend Ricky Baldwin is saying, well, we can't really blame the Democrats at the state level for not passing higher taxes on the rich, because there was even though
right.
they could do it and they have a veto-proof majority to do that, even if Rahner was to veto it, there's a few Democrats, whether in the Senate or the larger assembly, I'm not sure which side these Democrats are on, either or both, but they can't be done. So what's the point of having a Democratic Party? What's the point of having this position? And my feeling about it was that this is the way it always seems to go down. The Democrats just can't come up with those few extra votes they need, you know, to get generally progressive policies passed. You just can't, you know, Quinn became governor after a history of supporting single-payer health care. Once he became governor by basically accident, you never heard a thing about single-payer health care.
Exactly.
Why is that? If they really believe these things, why don't we hear about them? If the Democratic Party really supports a fair tax system, why don't they just go ahead and pass it? And it puts, I realize that it puts our local legislators, I will give Carol Ammons and Scott Bennett the benefit of the doubt that they want a more fair tax system, and they would want to pass that, but they're operating within a political framework in which this simply can't happen. And so they have to, on one hand, identify with that political framework and tell people that they should vote, in a sense, for that political framework, for that party, and on the other, you know, as opposed to, say, voting for the Green Party or any other party. And then they'll say, well, okay, you vote for that and we get into power, but nothing happens. And this has been happening you know, Obama to go back to the national level, he could have gotten a lot done in 2008 with the majority he had in Congress. He spent 2 years trying to pass privatized health care, bailing out Wall Street. A modest but not adequate stimulus package. And then he, and then because of that, because he moved to his right or was always on the right anyway, or was always a neoliberal anyway, the voters by 2010, by the 2010 midterm elections, the voters had lost interest in the Democratic Party.
Exactly. And we're not interested in windows into men's souls here, as Elizabeth I said, Ron. That's not the issue. The issue is what are the policies that political parties announce and what do they actually do? I'm suggesting there's more distinction there than we're usually willing to admit. People were willing to give these parties the benefit of the doubt. But that the progression in the reaction to Barack Obama from hope and change to he'd like to do it, but he's being prevented, to the realization that he was never anti-war or anti-Wall Street at all, and in fact that the policies remain continuous with what went before. That's what we're talking about. The difference between what's said publicly and what is actually done is the cynosure of our attention. That's what we should be looking at.
Yeah, I agree that there's a vast difference there in many cases. I think it was Dwight MacDonald who characterized Americans as talking like Boy Scouts and acting like gangsters.
Yeah, that's not a bad way.
Yeah, right.
It's a perennial.
Yeah, there's a big gap between what we say and what we do. A perennial, you might say, age-old problem of hypocrisy and so on. But yeah. I'm still puzzled about why you say the things that you do and then move on to condemning Obama personally as being a vicious, perfidious person.
I'm not interested in condemning Obama personally. I mean, what his...
What? You would do it constantly.
No, I condemn his policies.
I see.
I condemn his policies, and I condemn the obvious contradiction between his policies and what he is able to prevent, convince people that his policies were going to be. That's the real difference. It's the old good cop, bad cop scenario. The Democrats, particularly Obama, have tried to take the good cop position over against the Republican bad cops. Remember what that scenario really is. The bad cop says, I'm going to do bad things to you unless you do what I say. That's what the bad cop says. The good cop says, look, I'm really on your side. I'm going to help you, but you got to do what I say. Now, in that scenario, it's the good cop who's lying. The good cop is after the same goals as the bad cop, but he's misrepresenting those goals to the victim. That's the position of the Democrats. That's the position of the Obama administration. And also that's the position of the local Democrats as well. It's worked for the Democrats for a generation or more. That's what I'm talking about. Whether they even realize they're doing it, I don't care. What the state of their souls are, I don't care. Well, but I do care about how it works out in the body politic.
Well, you know, I'm sort of tempted to say, Ron, well, I do think Obama's a pretty bad person, but no, it doesn't really matter. It doesn't really matter. If he was a bad person who was, you know, someone who treated his wife badly or kicked his dog when he came home, you know, you could call him a bad person in some way or other, in that regard, but it doesn't matter what kind of person he is. What matters is he's made choices in his life to work within an institutional framework, to gain power within an institutional framework, which determines, in a sense, what his choices are. I would certainly be the first to say that those are not moral. He's not making conscious moral effort to do what I consider to be the right thing. He hasn't put thought into that. What he's put thought into, what he has to do to get the power that he's gotten, maintain the power that he's gotten, please the people that he has to please to maintain that power. You can talk about these things at a moral level, but they don't necessarily have anything to do with whether he's a nice guy who's fun to play hoops with and has nice children.
Fakes left and drives right.
Well, all that stuff.
Would you want to have a beer with him?
I don't.
No. No.
Even if I was a beer drinker, but still, no. I mean, we could bring this back down to the local level where it seems to get even more the confusion there. Again, as I'm always saying on this show, just because we're critical of people we know doesn't mean it's personal. So again, we're coming in. We have a couple of representatives, or at least one who we know, Carol Ammons. I don't know Scott Bennett. I expect that I'll have some opportunity to interact with Scott Bennett within the next year or two. But
mainly
but
because you want to run against him,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. I probably do.
Flavor, yeah.
But still, it isn't because I like Carol. She's a nice person. She's a good person. But the questions are becoming what it means to be a Democrat in this state context, whether we should support the Democratic Party as a party of hope and change,
yes,
like some people who I know and like still seem to want us to. And if they don't want to like me anymore for saying that, I guess I'm just going to have to accept that. I like to be liked as much as anyone else, but I'm kind of getting to the point where I'm getting really tired of trying to deal with this idea that the Democratic Party is something that can be, that we can have any hope for. I mean, this has been, I'm not as old as you guys are, but you know, since I've been hoping for hope and change for my teenage to adult life for almost basically 50 years now. I came up at a kind of a bad time in a sense that when I was impressionable, 14 years old, was when Lyndon Johnson was doing all the good things that Lyndon Johnson did, and I got off to my political life at a start with a lot of hope. And you could say I've had a slow learning curve since then if it's taken me 50 years,
yeah,
but it hasn't taken me that long. I mean, we need to be ready to move on beyond this two-party system.
Well, David, your likability is declining.
And your political future is therefore determined.
The polls have shown that. The polls have definitely shown that.
I guess I told you I was at a party the other night, and
someone saw
you on the television screen and told me that you deserve to be taken out and horsewhipped.
Well, that's probably to do with the whole Zionism thing.
Yeah,
than
it was.
Else, but,
and they didn't have a horse to do it Look, there is a. There are several problems intertwined here, I think. One is the one in which American politics declines from policy to personality.
Yeah.
Instead of asking a candidate, what will you do in office? Will you vote for this? Will you vote against that? And so forth. We now say, are you a nice guy or a nice woman?
Yeah.
And the question is, becomes one of character rather than policy.
Right.
Now, what that does, of course, is insulate the policies against any democratic disturbance, by lowercase d, democratic, any disturbance by voters, because we know we're going to get the same policy anyhow.
Yeah.
Who gets there? Therefore, we want to say, are we do we want to be ravished by a nice party or by a mean party? It gets particularly bad on that line. I'd like to make the equation or extension, perhaps, that David was suggesting earlier, though, and by saying there's not a million miles between the National Democratic Party and the local Democratic Party. By local, I mean the state of Illinois and in these districts. What we have is a party, a neoliberal and neoconservative party that continues to follow its policies, regardless of how they happen to be covered over with the personalities of the people who are doing it. We have a party that controls the state legislature that is able to run a pro-war and pro-Wall Street policy. It runs a pro-war policy with relationship to Senate Bill 1761, a support for Israeli apartheid. And remember, we've insisted all along that the U.S. support for Israel has nothing to do with domination of the American government by Zionists. It has a great deal to do with the policy of the United States government itself and Israel's usefulness to that policy. So we have here on the local level a vote on a bill that involves support for Israeli apartheid, and our local liberal representatives duck. The local Democratic Party is pro-Wall Street as well. We're told about the terrible economic problems that the state of Illinois has because it doesn't have enough tax revenue. The solution is out there. It's obvious. It's a financial transactions tax. It avoids the objection that taxing business will drive business out of Illinois, because these are businesses that cannot be driven out of Chicago. A tax on these financial transactions would produce the sort of money that the state of Illinois uses, the state of Illinois needs, and the Democrats could do that tomorrow with their majorities in both houses. House Bill 106 establishes such a tax. They don't do it. Now, why don't they do it? I don't know. You can argue about whether the problems are personal or political, but it seems to me that that's not very productive. The point is to see that they don't. They could and they don't. That is also true of the National Democratic Party. Pro-war, pro-Wall Street policies in both the state and national Democratic parties are simply a fact, whatever the psychological state of these people happens to be. And that's what we should be talking about.
And you know, analogous to Obama, you know, losing the control of the legislature in 2010, the reason Pat Quinn couldn't defeat a private equity sociopath like Bruce Rauner was because he didn't really present any kind of a leftist alternative, a non-neoliberal alternative to inspire people to vote for him. He, you know, Rauner was elected by apathy as much as anything else, I think.
You've been listening to News from Neptune. I'm Carl Estabrook. My discussants tonight have been David Green and Ron Szoke. Our thanks to our directors and producers, Jason Liggett and Dan Pano. See our Facebook page for News from Neptune and the blog, newsfromneptune.com. Inshallah, we'll be back next week with a new edition of News from Neptune to remind you, in the words of Edward DeVere, what's past is prologue, what to come in yours and my discharge. In the meantime, confusion to our enemies and a good night to you.